Welcome to Evolution Revolution. My name is Susan Allen, and I am thrilled to have you with us today. And as many of you know, the purpose of this show is to introduce you to breakthroughs in the human potential movement that work. And I know that, like me, you are committed to a life that is joyous and peaceful. It's your human birthright. If you're someone who has not been living or is not yet living a life of joy and peace and success and health and love and all of the commodities that are invisible but make everything worthwhile, you know that I offer a free one-hour telephone consultation. So let me see if there are tools and skills that I can suggest that would bring you in alignment. And you know that I have so many different and extraordinary guests, each with a different modality that I have experienced and that has transformed life. And you see me, I'm smiling. You run into me in the store, I'm smiling, and it's real. So today I am thrilled that once again Mirabai Devi is here with us. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you for having me on your show.
I'm so excited you're here. I had such a great time with you, you know, for the last few hours, and this, you know, the show's just starting. Okay, let me tell all of you about Mirabai. She is a conduit for the light and the divine feminine. She's just returned from South Africa, and this summer, Mirabai was a keynote speaker at the Bachtfest Festival, where thousands of attendees enjoyed learning from her teachings and learning about her practices. Over the years, she's offered spiritual teaching, darshan, and light activations to millions of people all over the world. And today, we're going to be discussing the gift that Mirabai offers that allows people's hearts to heal so that you can regain your open heart, so that a sacred relationship is both possible for you and desirable. You know, if your heart isn't open, you don't even want to think about a relationship. And even if you get to the place where you can think about it or want to think about it, you know that the magnetism isn't there. So possible and desirable. That's what today's show is all about. Okay, my first question. You travel the globe giving divine light transmissions. Can you give us an example of how someone who is feeling angry or even aggressive who came to one of your events was able to receive these transmissions and become peaceful?
I did a live demonstration of healing on Saturday night in Healing in America in Ojai. And somebody had come in that had a lot of negativity with them that they'd brought in with them that they'd had for over 9 years, maybe longer, even before I'd met them. And I'd known them for 9 years. And this was their moment. And during a light transmission that was individual, we were able to remove the darkness and the pain that was coming from the negativity that was attached to them, which of course sticks to a hook, and that hook has to do with our own anger or our own unworthiness. And that energy was removed, bringing about a feeling of immense joy, immense radiance of light, and incredible peace. And then the worthiness was able to be returned within that individual, and the self-love. That person is unrecognizable from the person that walked into that room that night. Complete transformation, beaming light and joy. And that will be for life.
Fabulous. Thank you. I feel like, you know, I was just in Ojai last week. I feel like going right back to Ojai and saying, okay, Mirabai, I think it's that person. I'm sure I would be able to tell the difference. Yes. Okay. Now, I've heard, from many people that this is where humans are entering the golden age, that this is a time of the great uplifting of the consciousness of the human race. Do you believe that it's true?
Yes. Yes, we are in the age of the new sun, known as the new Bakhtun by the Mayans. 12,500 years of the golden age of the sun. And that means increased light, closer to the sun, higher vibrational frequency, more intensification of everything because the light vibration is so high and so intense. That means we need to work on ourselves intensively to be able to resonate with the high vibration of the light that's coming into us.
Uh-huh. I had never heard it called the age of the sun.
Yes.
Even though I've certainly studied, you know, the Mayan calendar and all that. So thank you for that.
Yes.
And then what do
You're
we
welcome.
Need to do in order to cleanse the negativity from ourselves and also from our lineages? What do we do?
The forgiveness prayers are a series of prayers that cleanse negativity on all levels, physical, emotional, mental, spiritual, sexual, financial, psychological, and all levels completely, past, present, and future. They cleanse the karma. They're karma cleansing prayers. They're also healing prayers. And so that not only do they remove the veils of negativity, but they also, through the power of forgiveness, open the heart to love and to reconnect us with our natural state, which is light, through cleansing and purification. And so these prayers are essential tools, although forgiveness is an ancient formula, gratitude is an ancient formula, cleansing and purification are ancient techniques. There has never been a greater need than during this time of this golden age for us to use these tools to come back to our inner state of self-love.
You know, I am finding it so much easier most of the time. Different and easier. Not every minute of every day, but what's interesting, because I have a number of friends who are have been living in the light as much as humanly possible for decades, as you have. And when I find it wasn't so easy, like there were a couple of days last week when I found it was like trying to move through mud. And I just spoke to Reverend Bernard Goodman, who's a very gifted channel, and he said to me, oh, those days, I could hardly move. So I said, oh, okay, that's interesting. So it's awfully useful to check with other people who are on the path you're on so that you don't think, oh, there's something to be anxious about, something to be worried about. Because you know that being anxious or worried is going to make whatever there is going on less wonderful. So you want to avoid anxiety and worry no matter what. Now, my next question is, once we've cleansed with the forgiveness prayers and with your transmissions of the light, what are the guidelines to kind of stay on the path? How do we do that?
That's a beautiful question. To stay on the path, we need spiritual practice. Spirituality is not going to the church, not going to the synagogue or going to the temple on a Sunday morning and being preached at. Spirituality is turning your body, your mind, and your actions into your temple and purifying and cleansing your temple so that your path is sweet, removing obstacles within yourself through the grace of the divine light through spiritual practices like mantras and forgiveness prayers so that the karma isn't causing you to be in situations and circumstances that are negative. But cleansing so that your life becomes more and more positive makes it easier. Therefore, your choice of words is important. What you speak into the world is what you create. How you act, the actions that you bring, if they're of service, bring greater goodness back to you, bring greater positivity back to you. It's a formula. These are universal laws. Walking the path consciously helps you to stay awake, stay present, transforms your life.
And you know, for those of you who are tired of hearing me say it, isn't it nice to have a beautiful woman say the same thing and it's a new face and a new personality? It's like, don't listen to me, but listen to Mirabai Devi, please.
Will you?
Absolutely. Now, they have to, because they know if they don't listen to me and transform the way they think, listen, speak, and act, you're coming as the guest again soon in a few months, and you'll be back. So, you know, it's up to you.
Exactly.
Now, for everybody, the most challenging relationships are always the people that are closest to us. You know, you can endure and even enjoy certain behaviors from someone that you don't know very well or someone you don't see very often. But as soon as your husband, boyfriend, wife, girlfriend, mother, child does it, you're ready to rip your hair out or rip out theirs, right? Okay. Tell us about how your light transmissions ease this process for humans.
Okay, so the nature of our ego is to get triggered and to react. Light transmission neutralizes the reactions that we have. Reactions are natural as humans. If our physical, emotional, mental, and subtle bodies are uncleansed and unpurified and stuff is built up, the reactions become more intense. We can't even control our reactions because of the levels of stress. When those levels are cleansed on a daily basis through peacemaking, forgiveness prayer, spiritual practice, and particularly light transmission, where we're literally taking the burdens out of you, taking darkness out of you, taking negativity out of you, then you're able to maintain more and more of that neutral state of consciousness. When you're neutral, you're non-reactive, and you're able to enjoy your life. However, the people closest to you are going to be your greatest teachers because they do trigger you the most and they're able to get the most reaction out of you. And so you get to take 100% responsibility for your emotions and your feelings, thank them for being your greatest teachers and the opportunities that they bring to you to grow, and then utilize them. Use them as tools for growth, as lessons to develop and evolve. And then it's for a purpose, it's for a reason.
And you know, I practiced something last night that really saved my life. I'm not exaggerating. Instead of focusing on something that was really triggering me, and you guys know, I can teach you 26 different skills that allow you to unhook yourself. But I did something that was just so simple I wanted to share it with you, which is that I just kept focusing on what I wanted to see. That's all I did. And, you know, I'm such a doer. I'm so busy doing things and actually affecting change in the physical 3D world. I don't always remember to just change my internal state. And, you know, I do it on the freeway and the traffic jam moves. I did it at the event and the woman who was talking during an event got quiet and went into a meditative state. And then I stopped focusing on her and she started talking again. So I went back into that and I stopped again because my hand got tired and she started talking again. So it was proof. It was really proof that if you really focus on what you enjoy and you don't let yourself get all, you know, crazy, right? It can only help. Now, what about fear? Because we're talking about irritation, aggravation, anger, aggression. Now, what about fear? How do you work with that?
Well, first of all, I'd say that fear is the human disease, and it's what keeps us attached to negativity. It's an addiction. It's part of the suffering of our co-creation, the collective agreement that we've made as a human species during the old paradigm was a fear-based, victim-based, suffering-based paradigm. And so what do I do with fear? I break the paradigm. Mm-hmm. Breaking the paradigm means recognizing that you've been a victim your whole life, means realizing that suffering is martyrdom and martyrdom is passé. So moving on into a new paradigm, which is joy, means how can you eliminate suffering from every area of your life where you are attached to it, where your ego is addicted to it, where fear governs and controls you? Don't let it. if somebody comes to me individually, I show them how to not allow fear to dictate or govern their lives. I Wow. show them how to see that fear is false evidence appearing real, and that they can confront it and overcome it every time, and see that there is the divine God, the creator, in the center, underneath that fear, wearing a mask, giving you a divine opportunity to wake up and take back your power.
Fabulous. And they can't use evidence in the past to predict the future if they are learning new things in the present, right?
Beautifully said. And when you're in the present and you're choosing joy as your paradigm, then your future is created out of your present, so you will have yes. more of the same.
Yes. Oh. After I have to write these down and send them to you and everybody else that I know.
Thank you.
What a beautiful, two beautiful bookends.
Great idea.
Thank you. That was just delicious. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. Now, here's the juiciest of all the questions that one could ask. Intimacy, trust, and monogamy. So for some of you, intimacy requires trust and monogamy, and it's been that way your whole life. For some of you, intimacy does not require trust and or monogamy. I mean, I live in Santa Barbara with you, so I know a lot of you, and I know a lot of you all over the world as well who watch this show, so I know you. I know that what you may assume other people have a need for may not be the same for you, and vice versa. I notice that people's needs change. They may get more like this or less like this as they get older. Where does all of this fit in the divine feminine and the divine relationship?
Beautiful question. That's very deep. The first thing I'd like to say is that our primary relationship is with ourself, and integrity is everything. And if we are able to walk in integrity with ourselves and love ourselves and get the lessons that we're learning through any form of relationship as messages clearly that are helping us to burn through painful issues or patterns or lessons that we need to learn, then every person that comes into our life is a mirror. And every stage of our life, as we grow and evolve, has a different need. So the mirror, when we're younger, is to be free, is to experience many things, is to experience life. And that may be through many different partners, that may be through many different experiences. It's to experience that taste of freedom, and it's to experience travel, and it's to experience to be extroverted or out in the world or learning about our identity. As we grow older, perhaps, our needs change. We have more of a sense of wanting to be in an experience of a contained love that supports us, that's mutually supportive, that is mutually honoring, that is mutually respectful, and that form varies according to different individuals and their needs. Mm-hmm. And so I would say that the teaching of the divine feminine would be that ultimately it is better or best to experience love, sexuality in a committed container with integrity. And so the heart is the most protected, and there's the least amount of complications, because complications affect our health. Yeah. Lying affects our health. Mind games or mind trips affect our health. Not being real affects our health. Honesty is important. And so these are more qualities that we have to develop within ourselves, and are easier to develop within the container of a committed relationship.
Yes.
And this helps us go deeper in exploring love. Does that answer it?
Absolutely. And of course, you know, times have changed and the planet has changed and humanity has changed to a certain degree. And don't hate me because I grew up in the 70s and you didn't. It was wonderful. The easiest, luckiest time to be free that has ever come around for human beings so far. Let's hope it, you know, part of the golden age. Let's hope this returns, because it was thrilling. Now, I was very lucky, and a lot of you maybe have not been as lucky. And so many people have suffered with horrendous abuse of different kinds. And how do you heal the broken-hearted experience of either domestic violence, which you know I escaped from, but you know I was right there, and rape and all the horrendous things that happen? How do you heal someone's heart?
Sexual abuse. I've worked with so many people that have undergone molestation, sexual abuse, abortions, physical and sexual violence, extramarital affairs, heartbreak. All of this is, I have the greatest compassion for that level of pain and that level of heartbreak. And we all go through some level of pain and heartbreak. And the way that I focus on healing it with individuals is to start by looking at the universal laws. And the universal laws are that we are divine, that we are embodiments of love, that we are pure, that we are whole and complete, that no one wants to hurt another person unless they're hurting within themselves. And people act out of their own pain. And so we incarnate into this world and we have experiences that help us to realize we're not unworthy. We're worthy. We're not unlovable. We're lovable. We're not worthless. We're not undeserving. We're deserving of complete love, total respect, total kindness. And so when we shift the paradigm within ourselves, understanding we cannot change another person. We can change our past through peacemaking and forgiveness. We can cleanse it. We can cleanse the memories of it. We can take the jewels from the lessons, but we can't change other people. So when we change ourselves by empowering ourselves to see our own purity and love and what we deserve within ourselves and say no to anything else where we are given a conscious choice to be able to do so, in any circumstance, and take back our power, that helps us to not be vulnerable to any of that kind of negativity ever again. And it's a conscious choice we make to wake up and turn our lives around. And we really can protect ourselves. We really can be protected by the divine. When we're doing the inner work, everything changes. And we are cleansed, healed, and made whole, returned to our purity by the divine love that is within us, by reuniting and claiming that love for ourselves, by loving ourselves. So the most powerful act of healing is coming back home to loving yourself within yourself, to empowering yourself within yourself. And then we'll talk later on about forgiving all the perpetrators, forgiving all those that have hurt you, and cleansing the negative karma through forgiveness that has occurred in our lives.
Thank you. Now, I know that a lot of people want to hear the answer to this question. So many are looking for an enduring, lifelong relationship. And I know that you work with people for this, and that you have certain practices and transmissions for this. And everybody would love to hear one wonderful story of someone who found an enduring love and that this was everything that he or she longed for.
Well, first of all, it seems to be a desire that is very common, that many people have come to me and asked for help to pray in and ask for their life partner or their beloved. And when they do so, I have asked them to make a list of all of the negative actions, all of the negative patterns, and all of the negative experiences of past relationships, and to look at themselves within who is the person that they have been, and how can they become the best version of themselves? How can they become the person that they ultimately want to be with and are going to attract into their lives? They need to be a resonant match, to vibrate in resonance with what it is that they're attracting in their partner. And they're not that person yet. So first we get them to remove the blockages, the belief systems, and the negative karma that's locking them into the opposite, which is heartbreak, which is at an unconscious level pushing away their partner or their beloved because they're still hurt. Even though their mind says, I want my life partner, their heart says, no way, not having it, too painful. Memories are too hard. So we cleanse those memories. We heal them with the divine light transmissions. We focus on giving a person a practice of forgiveness prayers and then give a relationship mantra, a mantra to attract your life partner, and then focus on asking the divine light to draw that person into their lives. And inevitably, sometimes we need to go through a series of lessons where the wrong person or the wrong partners will come through, flash through very quickly so we can see what we don't want. And sometimes we engage in that and sometimes we don't. And then the right person shows up and we're able to move into life partnership. And I'd like to say that there have been, you asked me for one person, there have been many different people that have asked me to help them manifest this in their lives and have been very successful at finding their beloved, and their beloved has been with them through. I have one woman who asked me to help manifest her beloved into her life. She had been a nun. We manifested her beloved for her birthday present. And unbeknownst to all of us, at some point later down the line, she developed cancer and has been through a series of hospital treatments dealing with this cancer for years, and her beloved has been by her side as her spokesperson, fighting for her rights, supporting and protecting her through the entire process. And she has said to me on a numerous number of occasions, I would have died if he had not been there fighting for my life and holding my hand and by my side. That was God's gift to me in this lifetime. I wouldn't have made it without that. And that's one of the most beautiful stories that I can share that's with true. You. And that came out of a birthday wish and a prayer answered from a session we did with her.
Wow. Thank you. That's so inspiring. Now, we know that for thousands of years, at least, but probably a lot longer, on the planet Earth, there has been the suppression of the divine feminine. And if you're a guy watching this, you know this is true too. And we've seen this in so many different areas. Tell us about how you see this unfolding, because you transmit the divine feminine. So this is something that, you know, 500 years ago, 4, 3, 2, even 100 years ago, would not have been possible.
Beautiful. Well, the divine feminine is being restored on the planet because it has been suppressed for so, so long. And it's been suppressed, as you said, in men and in women. And it wasn't possible because we were in the thick of the Dark Ages. And that's why we saw so much violence and war and aggression and negativity and greed and control, because the feminine qualities of nurturing, of compassion, of humility, of kindness, of unconditional love, of forgiveness, of gentleness. These qualities were missing and suppressed and seen as weakness on our planet. And so now, part of my work and part of my role on Earth at this time is not only to help Mother Earth and Mother Nature as she goes through her ascension into the next level of her evolution, as a divine mother, to empower herself and say no to all of the abuse, but also to empower women to step into their divine feminine and not to have to be like men, but to accept their feminine and divine feminine qualities and liberate and empower themselves so that they can be a force in the world, doing their work, living and fulfilling their purposes, and be in healthy relationships with everyone in their lives, as well as helping men restore the ability to have that balance with feeling their feelings, allowing their emotions, being more kind and loving and gentle and compassionate, nurturing themselves and others, all of these qualities that have not been allowed for so long now must be restored on the planet so that we can see balance come back to nature. And it's essential for our species of humanity to survive on this earth that the divine feminine is restored and brought back into balance. And it's essential for each one of us to restore it within ourselves as well as the planet as a whole during this time of the golden age of the new sun.
That's very clear. And now the big question is, people who've gone through the most excruciating separations, really painful divorces, how does the light transmission that you offer heal that experience?
My heart just, I feel that so deeply in my heart. You know, I really feel so, I feel so much compassion for all of your pain, those of you that have been through divorces, those of you that have been through painful heartbreaks. I know what that's like. There's nothing more painful than being in heartbreak in human form, whether it's, you know, a girl, a daughter whose father has abandoned her and her mother through a divorce, or the other children and siblings through a divorce, or whether it's being lied to as a child by a parent, or whether it's being abandoned by a lover, a partner, a spouse, through somebody cheating on somebody and leaving, or somebody completing or ending a relationship and moving on, the other partner isn't ready, or even through death, which we're going to explore more of. As we learn and grow more spiritually, we'll come to understand more and more how heartbreak and death can also be resolved. But the reality is that the heart can be healed, and these painful hurts can be brought to peace. And how we do that is through directly opening the heart through utilizing spiritual practices of forgiving and making peace with the people that have hurt us, not for them, but for ourselves, through cleansing and purifying all of the layers of resentment, hatred, jealousy, fear, self-negation, negativity, projections out of ourselves. Because that resentment is poison to us. It poisons our body. So when we clean it out of ourselves, forgiveness is for ourselves. And then automatically we are free. And when we're free, we can see that that person was an actor. They were a channel to bring a lesson into our lives. And we get the lesson. And when we truly get the lesson, we don't have to keep repeating the experience over and over and over again. We finally do, good news, we finally do heal that pattern, and it no longer has to happen. And how we know we've healed that pattern is when it doesn't happen anymore. So we heal the heartbreak, we heal the hurt, and we come back to love. And we open our hearts with joy, and we move on in our lives, and we heal our bodies in the process, because our bodies get sick and break down through heartbreak. And this is something we'll talk more about.
And your body can be healed after everything, and I'm the living proof of it. Because when Mirabai went through that whole list, there are very few things that I haven't lived through on that list, which is one of the less than fun things about getting older, that you've had this long life and you've had all these experiences. But the trick, the key, is have you forgiven yourself and forgiven all of them? And when you think about it again, do you forgive yourself and forgive all of them? And, you know, for me, it's as if most of those things happened to somebody else who looks sort of like me, you know, as a younger me, looks sort of like me, but I can hardly believe that all those things actually were my own experience. Because the cells in our body are gone after 7 years. So what are we dragging all this experience forward for, you know? Now, many of you have lost loved ones, and you certainly know that I have. And how to communicate with them, how to really be in the presence of that beloved after death, what can you tell us?
I just recently lost a family member and went back home to South Africa to help the family and to pray and do prayer healing. and healing work with them. And part of what I was sharing with them, and of course, as soon as I got back to the US, within 1 week, every client in every private session had gone through death of a loved one, and it was all coming at once because we attract it in groups, and the lesson comes that way. And what I was sharing with all of these people, my family and my various clients that have come forward in this kind of level of pain, is that our human eyes, our human mind is so trained to be attached to the form. And when the form dissolves, we don't know how to connect to the spirit, because we're not trained to do so. We're not trained to believe that there's life after death. We're not trained to believe that the spirit lives on eternally, even though all of the religions teach that, and even though spirituality is based on that. Humans have shut that gift down, that ability down, which is natural to each and every one of us. And so it gives us this divine opportunity to begin to connect beyond the form and communicate with our loved one, first of all, by lighting a candle, a white candle, for at least a minimum of 30 days past the soul departing from the body, and having photographs or an altar, flowers of the loved one, and creating the celebration of that being's freedom into eternal life, that they're no longer in pain, they're no longer suffering, they're now free and able to fully be alive in whatever form they're evolving into, in whatever experience they're having. We don't want to hold them back. We bless them and we release them. When we grieve for ourselves. We grieve the sadness of our loss or missing of the form, and we grieve for our family members, but not for the soul that has departed. And then we communicate with them, we connect with them, and we talk to them exactly as if they were in Australia or in the other side of the world. We just communicate with them with our hearts. We send them love on a daily basis. Every time we feel the pain arising, send them love. Every time you feel the separation, send them light. Every time you feel you can't communicate with them, speak to them and listen to what they say to you. Listen to what they have to share with you in your own heart. If you practice, you will hear them, because the connection is that strong. And that will help you to overcome the separation that your mind and ego has created. And you will come to realize that we are all together all the time, and we cannot be separated, because our souls are always together. And that's the greatest love.
Thank you. And now I think we want to hear the definition, your definition, of a sacred relationship, because we've been speaking about them, we've been speaking about how to prepare for them and how to bring one in and how to resonate with it and how to magnetize it. What is the actual definition for you?
The definition of a sacred relationship to me is when you have been through all of the heartbreaks, the tests, the trials, and the tribulations that we've been talking about on this show, and you come to the point in your life where you finally forgive yourself, where you finally forgive all the people that have hurt you and are in the process of continuing to forgive them, and you begin to treat yourself as sacred, and you begin to see the sacredness of all life, and you are at peace with yourself. You've come to the point where you have realized that you don't need to allow into your life any more abuse on any level, physical, emotional, verbal, mental, spiritual, sexual, financial, psychological. You bring the sword and cut and say no to any disempowering experience, person, partner, or situation, and reach the point where you are unified with your own self-love, your sacred relationship with yourself becomes so strong that your relationship with your partner will only and can only be sacred, because you will only allow into your life that which is sacred. And everything, because none of us are perfect, in that sacred container of relationship can be communicated peacefully, can be worked through honestly, and dealt with by doing the work if we allow it. And that is a sacred relationship.
Yes. And are they more important for people now, at this time in history, in the Golden Age? And why?
The reason why they're more important now than ever before in this sacred time during this Golden Age is because our vibrational frequency has raised so high that we are in a time of instant karma. Didn't George Harrison sing about instant karma? So what that means is that what you think, you manifest just like that. You create. What you focus on, you get. What you say out loud, that's what you have. You create your own reality. So if you are manifesting instantaneously what you are creating through your thoughts, words, and actions and beliefs, then you better be in a sacred relationship, because if something vibrates in resonance, it's going to last. If something does not vibrate in resonance and it's discordant, it's going to leave your life so fast. Anything which is not serving you, which is not for your highest good, and which is not the truth, is going to burn up, disappear, turn upside down on its head, and flee out of your life. And don't be sad. Don't be distressed. Don't be hanging on to it. Allow it to leave, because it's not the right thing. It's not for your highest good. Only sacred relationship is going to hold the resonance for your highest good, because the energy frequencies are too high to allow or handle anything lesser, unless you're still choosing to learn through a lot of pain and suffering, which I encourage all of us to let go of and break the paradigm.
There is another way. There really is. We can tell you how to get there from here. You can get there from here. You know. Now, the real question is connecting through peacemaking to God, to the light, in a deeper and more experiential way. What does that look like? Because I don't know that everyone who's watching the show really has an experience. So we're saying that they should do it, and we're saying that you'll help them do it, and we're saying that, but I'd love you to really explain what that's like for people.
Well, experiencing God, God is love, and love is in your own heart. And when you're holding your baby in your arms and looking into its eyes, that's divine love. When you look into the eyes of your best friend, and they're so kind to you and so compassionate and so loving and so present, and you see God coming through their eyes, that's love. That's God. You're experiencing it. It's not just going into higher states of consciousness and unifying with the divine within, but it's also coming through the hearts and the eyes and the hands of caring and loving people all around you all the time. And the more that you practice love, the more you're going to experience love. So you can develop that connection to God by developing more of your own love. And as you develop more of your own love, you'll experience more of the connection with God. And take time to meditate on a beautiful sunset, on a beautiful painting, on a beautiful piece of music, anything that inspires you and takes you into that, that open state of consciousness is going to take you into a union with God experience. And then ultimately, those of you that are still developing and practicing can learn through peacemaking and forgiveness and cleansing and spiritual practice to experience, when the blocks move out of the way, you're in a state of union with the divine, with God, because it's your natural state. You're connected with the light naturally. We're just removing what's in the way so you can experience God all the time, which is within you, your natural divine state, which is the beloved within. And that's what we're leading you to and reminding you of, because you already know that.
Okay, and then you also have, I think, three keys for maintaining a really loving relationship.
Yes.
And any loving relationship is going to go through times when it's really easy.
Yes.
And not so easy.
Yes. One, the first key is truth. when you are lying or deceiving or cheating or dishonest, your relationship cannot sustain because you're only lying to yourself. You can only hurt yourself because the other is a mirror reflection of you. So truth is a fundamental key to the pillar of a successful relationship. No matter what, the truth is essential. And many, many people will have to evolve a long way before they're brave enough to reveal the truth all the time. And so it calls you to a much, much higher level. The second is integrity. Integrity is slightly different to truth because integrity means that you're listening to your inner guidance and you're following what you know to be right. And you're doing what you feel guided is the highest thing to do for yourself and for others. And so when you're in integrity, you're always going to be doing in that moment what feels like caring for yourself, loving yourself, honoring yourself, which is automatically going to spill over into your partner, and they're going to feel the right timing, the right energy, the right respect, because you're resonating that integrity with yourself, and so it's going to spill into your partner as you honoring them, you're honoring their truth, you're honoring their integrity, and you're both going to be able to vibrationally match when you're both holding that integrity with each other. And so a commitment has to be made both ways. And the third thing, as you know, Susan, as you teach, is open communication, compassionate communication, loving communication, when you can communicate through the difficulties and you can communicate through the challenges and you can be real with each other instead of masking or hiding or playing games or pushing or pulling or pretending you're not who you are or who you think you are. Drop all of that and move into an honest, compassionate, loving, kind communication and communicate how you really feel. Honestly, with love, at any opportunity that you're given, both ways, both partners need to do it. And then your relationship, when it's based in truth, honesty, integrity, and compassionate, loving communication, has the highest chance for survival, because you're honoring each other, you're respecting each other, you're honoring yourselves, you're respecting yourselves, you're loving each other, you're loving yourselves. Everything else is an ego dance and is only going to be destroyed because it's not based in truth. And anything based in illusion will be destroyed. And so ultimately, it cannot be sustained by the universe or by the natural laws or by the universal laws. Same thing, whether it's with God or with yourself or with any relationship or with the relationship with your spouse or your lover or your beloved, it works in every single area of your life. These are three fundamental key pillars of the success of a relationship, a sacred relationship.
And then the question about being a yogi or a yogini, in other words, being celibate and devoting one's life to spiritual practices and the pursuit of bliss and joy and nirvana, or as so many of the ancient Hindu sages, they were married to one another, to whoever, at very young ages, that was just the tradition, and then they had to carve out time for themselves or convince their spouse that they wanted to live like brother and sister. You know, it's a very tricky thing. So what is your perspective in teaching about that?
Well, it depends on what tradition you come from, and everyone should honor their own tradition that feels natural to them and good to them. Nobody's tradition is going to necessarily be imposed on anyone else's. But what I would like to say is that celibacy has to come naturally. It has to arise from within you that that's your natural desire. You can't come to celibacy because you're running away from hurt and heartbreak and pain in your previous relationships or in your life. If it's used as a mask or a cave to hide in, it's not authentic. And if it's imposed, it's not authentic. The only time it's healthy to be imposed, if there's been some level of negativity and acting out, then it is helpful to impose celibacy for a period until those energies, those sexual energies, get cleaned up or cleansed. But in reality, celibacy is a natural desire that comes to certain individuals who feel the need to be alone with God during that phase of their development when it feels right, and it must arise from within. If it's superimposed, it gets twisted and comes out sideways and becomes extremely destructive. And we've seen that case in molestation of boys in large spiritual organizations around the world, across the world's religions, and also because people are imposing celibacy and enforcing something on themselves that's not natural. It's much healthier for people to be in loving, committed relationships where they're able to explore their sexuality in a sacred container and also be able to evolve spiritually at the same time. It's a much healthier model for the world. And yes, there are monks and nuns and yogis that authentically have needed to be celibate to learn about their spiritual evolution. And we're moving into a time now where we're very much in the world. The world is growing everywhere. There's life 3D buzzing, you know, bursting out of the seams in every single area of our planet. And so we are in the world, and we can't impose something unnatural. The best is to try to attain enlightenment within a sacred relationship, within a body, within the world, whether you want to say a city or the country or not, or a town. Be in the world and learn to transcend by being in the world these negative energies or oppressive forces that hold your spirituality back by evolving in the midst of challenge, because that's going to evolve you higher than running away from the world and never having to overcome or deal or strengthen or empower yourself to deal with these many, many distractions that are going to come anyway as soon as you expose yourself to the world, which you eventually have to do. And so it's better, I feel, to do that within a healthy way, within a healthy container. And of course, you know, in India, they had talked about the phases of life. You're a child, you're a student, you go to university, and then you get married, and then you have children, and then you become a renunciate, and then you focus on your spiritual life. And yet the way that the world is moving now is that we focus on our spiritual life while we're married or having children or having sacred relationship containers, whether even if they're not marriage, and even if they're not children, we can practice our spirituality now within those containers. We don't need to wait and carve out that area of our life, because we don't live in those old models and paradigms quite in the same way as we used to, because the world has changed so much. The planet has changed so much. It's evolved, and it's a very different level of ingredients that are making a different soup. And so we handle the soup that we're being presented with now with different kinds of adaptations and healthier ways of adapting and thriving, not surviving. And we can thrive in spiritual enlightenment, in sacred relationships in the world during the 21st century. That is the goal. And that is very doable and very attainable.
Thank you. Now, before we speak about love, because love as the highest vibration is a fairly common understanding now, but for me, as I've aged, I've noticed that my experience of love for the divine really looks from inside, it looks identical when I was in love with a guy. Because it was me loving with all my heart. You know, me loving with that level of intensity. And I remember sometime in my mid-50s, when I was planning this trip to the Oneness University, which was a 21-day experience with a couple of days in between, you know, adjusting in Chennai before you go, etc. And I laughed and I said, you know, Susan, if you were any younger, there would be no chance of me going somewhere for like a month and being celibate. And I thought, well, now, Susan, you're 56, or it was 56. It's not even a thought. I'm free. So that ancient concept of renunciate hit me, that it was just common sense. It's easy when you're in your 50s. It was impossible in my 40s, 30s, 20s, or teens. It just was natural. Mm. So talk to us, if you would, and we just have a few minutes, about the exquisite, ecstatic vibration of love when you are just connected to the divine, which is something that everyone hasn't experienced.
Well, just so happens that's my favorite thing to talk about. And that's what I talk about all the time. And ever since I was a little girl, I've been an ecstatic. I've had ecstatic experiences of union with the divine light and with the beloved since I was 3 years old throughout my entire life. And now I'm 43 and this body. And what has happened is that I have broken through the veils that separate us and seen that every molecule, every atom, every fiber of this universe is composed of love, is created by love, and is sustained in love, divine. And that love is so blissful, so ecstatic. Just one drop of that love is like the sweetest, sweetest nectar of ecstasy, just a drop of it. And can you imagine what the totality of it is like? The light is so blinding and so intense that they used to describe, the mystics would describe in the sacred scriptures, that they could only handle small amounts of it at a time because it would just burn you up. It's so intense. And so this is the nature of the divine. This is what we have to look forward to, is this experience which becomes our eternal reality. Not only when we leave the body, but when we're still in the body, we can attain the experience of divine love and be in union with that. And that is the priority and the focus of our lives. There's nothing more important than divine love. There's nothing more important than opening the heart so that you can experience that.
Thank you so much. And we need another 5 hours. So you have to come back as soon as you can possibly come back.
Yes, I would love to.
Thank you, Susan. We want to do our next show. Tell me if you agree. Send me an email. Let me know. I think we want to do our next show on the merging with the divine and divine love. That's what I would like to do the show about.
Beautiful.
Think about that, if you will, when you're not in Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
That to me is something that each and every one of you, I want you to experience this. I want you to have this experience. Okay, so tonight, Mirabai Devi will be at Center of the Heart. The program begins very, very soon. It begins at 7 o'clock, and we hope you will be there, 7 till 10, Center of the Heart on Turnpike, and it's 487 North Turnpike. You probably know exactly where it is. I will be on my dear friend Gigi's show, The Compassionate Connection Show, the second and the fourth Tuesday of this month and every month. It's been 8 years and on it goes. And you will be able to see my guest, Reverend Bernard Goodman, on Evolution Revolution, which will be on the first Tuesday of November. And I am so thrilled that you were able to join us. It's been an amazing month with the first show with Howard Wills, and now the show with Mirabai Devi, and can't thank you enough. And I want to thank Mark and JP, who pinch hit today. They have never directed and done audio for this show before together, and so I'm so grateful. Thank you to both of you. Thank you to everybody else at Santa Barbara Channels, to Matt and to Dominique, and to Jared on vacation. I hope you're having a wonderful time. And Tyler, who is returning from China any day, and they will be back for November, I imagine. And thank you so much.